Welcome, food and fitness lovers, to Tina's Ageless Kitchen. I'm Chef Tina Martini. You might know me as the Medicine Chef. Welcome, food and fitness lovers, to Tina's Ageless Kitchen. I'm Chef Tina Martini. You might know me as the Medicine Chef. Well, today it's Classics Reimagined, and my signature dish is beef Wellington. Now, you can use any kind of meat that you like. Lamb works beautifully here, but today we're going to do a beef tenderloin. The first thing I want to talk about with Wellington is the ability to get the beef perfectly medium rare and keep the crust or the pastry around the Wellington crisp and light and not soggy on the bottom. That's the toughest part out of the Wellington. So what we're going to do is reimagine the Wellington and make it easy on you in your kitchen at home. All right, I've got some puff pastry here. And remember, when you buy puff pastry from the store, you want to temper it the night before in the refrigerator. What that means is you're going to just take the box of puff pastry out of the freezer and park it in your refrigerator until you're ready to use it. Now, tempering it means just controlling the temperature. And we've talked about tempering before. It's a really great technique for keeping the pastry at an even temperature so you get that light, flaky result. Now, generally speaking, for pastry, the rule is make it cold, bake it hot. So I've got the oven preheated to 375. Now, I've got a little biscuit cutter, and remember that we're reimagining the classic Wellington so that you can enjoy all the crispy pastry and the lovely duxelle flavors of the wild mushrooms and, of course, the delicious beef tenderloin, but we're going to make it really easy to happen, even on a weeknight. So what I'm going to do is just cut some rounds here, and that's going to be the top of our reimagined Wellington. Now remember, we don't want to throw this away because we could easily just put some jam or jelly inside and make little turnovers for our loved ones. So this is a good way to make the most out of our money. All right, so we've got the little rounds. And if they're kind of raggly on the edge there, you can just tuck them back. That's going to be fine. Now, if we don't dock the puff pastry, and remember, puff pastry is layer after layer of butter with the pastry folded over. That's how it poofs up and gives that really flaky texture. If we don't dock it, it's going to puff really high. So let's dock it just a little bit with a fork, and that's going to give some air holes. And that way it's going to puff up and be crispy, but it's not going to raise too high up. For this particular recipe, we don't want it puffing up too much. So there, I've just docked it with the fork, and now I have some cream and an egg yolk, just a classic egg wash, and it's going to give it a nice, beautiful color. Let's go ahead and just brush this quickly. Try not to get too much on the sheet pan. Let's just kind of keep it on the pastry, and that way we won't get any burning or sticking. This looks good. Now, the answer is yes, we do want to flavor this definitely so that every layer has flavoring. So I'm just going to crack a little bit of salt over it, and I'm using a coarse grade sea salt, and then I'm going to use just a little bit of black pepper. Now, that's going to give a nice look. You could even put some dried herbs here if you wanted, and that would be terrific. So let's quickly go ahead and pop that in, and it's probably just going to take about 4 to 5 minutes. So we'll put this in the oven, and then it's time to sear the beef. All right, so our pastry is going to work in the oven for 4 or 5 minutes. Let's get our pan started, and we're going to sear our beef. So first, I'm going to put a little bit of grapeseed or some kind of neutral oil in the pan, and we'll get that nice and hot. All right, so we're going to sear the beef tenderloin in the grapeseed oil, and that way we're going to get all those delicious brown bits in the pan, which we're going to use later in the sauce. All right, our pan's hot, so let's go ahead and get our tongs, and we're going to put our beef tenderloin right in. Now, isn't this looking great? I'm going to just season that right now. Let's give a little bit of pepper. Now, B12 helps us manage stress, and of course, none of us have stress in our life now. Well, that's a joke. We all are living stressful lives. So we really need to get those good quality sources of B12 in our diet. Now we want to sear the beef all the way around so that we seal in those beautiful juices. So let's go ahead and just pick this up off of our pan. And if it's a little resistant at first, just go ahead and grab it and turn it over. Remember, you're the chef. You dominate the food in your kitchen. Don't let the food dominate you. All right, so while this is searing, let's look at our other ingredients that are going into our sauce. Now remember, we're replicating beef Wellington, which would normally be the seared tenderloin with a dry mushroom duxelle on top and then wrapped all in the puff pastry. But what I'm gonna do is make a mushroom masala sauce that we're just gonna nappe over the beef when it's finished, and then we can park one of our little puff pastry rounds on top. That way, when you cut into it, you get the beauty of the crispy pastry, the delicious wild mushroom flavor, and then, of course, the delicious seared beef. Now, a good way to go here when you've got this thick of a cut of beef is to sear it all the way around and finish it in the oven. It depends on how rare you like your meat, and I certainly hope we're not eating our meat well done. You're killing all of the good nutrients. So if you can go mid-rare and really no more than medium, you're gonna get a much better source of nutrients. So I've got some marsala wine here. I've got some beef broth. Now you're probably gonna think this is a little odd, but we're using a vegan beef broth with beef. Now, why would I do that? Well, the reason is because I feel that any way that we can reduce the animal products in our diet is only going to be beneficial, again, as I said earlier, for the environment and for ourselves. And this is a very rich, delicious product, so there's really no reason to duplicate beef on beef if you don't have to. So another incredible flavor component of this delicious sauce that we're making are these mushrooms. And I did use dry mushrooms here, but you can see that I've poured hot water over them and reconstituted them. Now we've got all different kinds of dry mushrooms that we can use. The porcini, the shiitake, these happen to be oyster, and they're all delicious and they all offer a little different flavor profile. Mushrooms are one of the best ways to substitute meat when you're converting your family to a little less meat products or animal products. Now, I don't want to throw this broth away. It's really just mushroom broth, and it's going to add another layer of flavor. So I'm going to strain that right in to our beef stock. And that way, again, we're gonna have that nice earthy flavor. Now, our beef is looking good over here, and we just wanna keep turning it. Look at that gorgeous caramelization there, getting that flavor of the beef to really come forward. All right, so we've got beef stock here, that's the vegan beef stock, and we've got the mushroom broth here, and this is some marsala wine. We're gonna cut in some butter and cream later, and just so you could see what the dry mushroom looked like, this is a little chanterelle, and again, all I did was pour the hot water over. So let's go ahead and dice these up. If the stems are really woody, you don't want to put those in, but usually some of the stems are tender enough to use. All right, so we'll put that to the back. Let's make some room to work, chefs. That's always good. All right, and we're just going to run our knife through. Let me move this out of the way. These are kind of woody here, so let's go ahead and just cut those off. All right. Now, the mushrooms, they're a really great way to substitute meat when you're working on converting your family to a less animal-based nutrition program. Let's get all the stems out of here. All right. Now, I want you to rough cut these mushrooms. And that way we're gonna have a little more texture to our sauce. Now, a duxelle would normally be mushrooms ground more fine. But I want a little bit of texture and I want us to be able to see what we're eating. Now, what else do mushrooms do for us? Well, they boost the body's natural enzyme capacity and that helps us to fight disease like cancer. Let's go one more side here. We're looking good with our beef. And then we'll get ready to make our sauce. All right, so our mushrooms are prepared. I'm just gonna throw some thyme in, and you'll see that I'm just throwing the whole stem with the leaves. You don't have to bother stripping the leaves off. As we work the sauce, the leaves are gonna come off, and then you can use your tongs just to pluck the stem out. All right, I'm going to let the beef rest on a little plate. Let's just park this here, and it can wait for us. And we're going to deglaze the pan with our marsala wine. Now, what does that mean? Well, that means that we're going to pick up all those little brown bits, and you can see those coming off the pan. There we go. I'm going to turn the fire up just a little bit, and remember this does have alcohol in it, so be careful. There we go. We're going to burn that alcohol off, and let me just pick up all of those bits, and that is the most wonderful flavor. Okay, looking good. You think that's good enough, chefs? I think we've got it. Now let's go ahead and add our mushrooms in. Perfect. I'm going to season this in just a moment. Let's get our shallots going. We don't want to put any color on the shallots. Just soften them a little, and already the aroma is amazing. Okay, throw the thyme in, and we're good to go. I've got some cold butter here. I'm going to add just a little bit of our stock. I'm going to reduce this down just a little bit. And that's our mushroom and our beef stock. We'll put that to the back. I'm going to really kick the fire up now, and we're going to reduce again just by about a third is fine. All right, so we've got lots of medicine here. Now remember, thyme has a pigeonin in it, and it's also got rosmarinic acid. Rosmarinic acid and a pigeonin are both showing up to be a great way to fight anxiety. A lot of people, we talked about stress earlier, are experiencing high levels of anxiety in their life. So the natural herbs like basil, thyme, rosemary really help to calm the nervous system and bring that anxiety down. All right, we're looking good here. The shallots are nice and soft. I've used enough wine. I think I'll go ahead and park this in the back. Let's go ahead and re-season. Now, chefs, we want to taste everything that we're making so that we know where we're at. So don't over-season. Let this go on high for a minute. All right, so we're going to let our sauce reduce, and then we'll add our cream and our butter. All right, so you can see that our sauce is perfectly reduced. Let's go ahead and pull those stems out of the sauce. We put our thyme in on the stem, and that just makes our life a little easier. We get the flavoring without having to strip off each of the leaves. Now go ahead and take the fire completely off here so that we don't curdle the cream. I've got some heavy cream, and you don't need much. We're just going to add that right in. Beautiful. And you can see what you need here. Just a little bit will do it. All right, that looks gorgeous. And then let's go ahead and cut in our cold butter. Now, using the cold butter, of course, creates that beautiful gloss, and that's how most pan sauces are finished in the restaurant business. All right, beautiful. Now, do use real butter, of course, here, because nothing has the flavor of butter. And then you can see that the mushrooms are nice and tender. Let's scrape down the bits. Always picking up those bits off the bottom of the pan. And I'm going to add one more pat of butter. Now, it's best, chefs, just to wait until the butter's all the way incorporated. That way you don't lose the temperature on the sauce. We can put this aside and just hold it. We're going to finish our beef in the oven, and that's going to be a great way to keep that moisture in and keep that nice sear that we worked so hard on earlier. Okay, so the butter's already cut in. The sauce looks beautiful, as you can see. Hold it on the side. Don't cover it all the way, chefs. Leave a vent. You don't want condensation to build up and all that water to go in your beautifully reduced sauce. We're going to finish the beef in the oven. The puff pastry is ready to go. And when we come back, it's a twice-baked potato reimagined. Welcome back to the Ageless Kitchen. Now, I've got one of the best foods to slow the aging clock. Big hormone balancer here, important for both men and women. I've got a yam for you. Some people like sweet potatoes. Both grow in the ground. Both are loaded with beta carotene to keep the skin beautiful. But more than anything, the yam contains something called prostaglandins. Now, prostaglandins in the body are messengers, and they really help women with delivering children. They help men with maintaining a healthy prostate. So there's all kinds of good news here, as well as being loaded with trace minerals. I'm going to show you how I prep the yam to go in the oven. Now I've got it high and dry. We're going to roast the yam. So let me just move my salt here. carefully take a sharp knife and just make one pierce through the potato. Now, the reason I'm not poking it all over the place is because the steam will come out all over the place and it will wet the skin and make for a really rubbery, really damp skin. We want it to be really nice and crisp and dry, and that's going to give us the best result for a nice jacket around our potato. I've got a pastry brush and a little bit of olive oil, and I'm just going to brush it all over. And that's going to keep it moist, and it's also going to help the skin crisp up. Now, I like olive oil because at this moment, in this particular recipe, it's going to add another layer of flavor. All right, that's perfect. Let's move this to the side, and then let's go ahead and salt. Now, we're reimagining the twice-baked potato, which is yet another one of our beautiful gourmet classics. It's a little bit old school, but still a great favorite of everyone's. So now that I've showed you how I prepare it for roasting, we've already got one done here. So we'll just take that to the side for now and let's work on this one. Now this one's been roasted and it had the oil and the salt already on it, and that's gonna give us a nice layer of flavor. Let's take the tip and just open it right up. Now remember, we're doing a twice-baked potato reimagined, so we wanna keep the skin as nice as we can. Just open that up and let's take a spoon and just take out the majority of the pulp here. And we're gonna flavor that and then restuff the potato. So you can see the gorgeous orange skin, and of course that's beta carotin, and that's what the human body uses to make vitamin A. All right, so we've got the pulp out, a little bit of fresh squeezed orange juice for our limonene and our bioflavonoids. Bioflavonoids turn back the aging clock really well. All right, little bit of coconut. Now coconut, really great stuff with its medium chain triglycerides. And the reason I chose the coconut is really this isn't only a hormone balancing dish, but it's also skincare from the inside out. Now I've taken some egg white and some brown organic sugar and candied the pecans. You can buy some nuts that are already candied if you'd like. And we're just gonna run our knife right through that. And then I'm gonna blend it right into our pulp. So let's get over there with the nuts. Now, leave them a little bit chunky so you have some texture. As a matter of fact, if you don't wanna use your knife at all, you can just break them right up. We're gonna use this to top the potato as well. So I don't wanna put too much in. I'm gonna add just a little bit of salt. As with baking, we always put a little bit of salt in to lift the sweetness up. Just mash that in. That looks good. Now, something else that might be good here would be a little melted butter, a little bit of vanilla. We're gonna put that right back into our skin. I'm gonna top that with a little bit of the shredded coconut. And being twice baked, we're gonna pop it in the oven just for a couple minutes and let that coconut get nice and toasty. Let's go like so. We'll break a couple of the nuts up over top, sprinkle it with the coconut, and it's ready to go into the oven just for a couple minutes, just to give that nice toast on the coconut. And when we come back, it's another classic reimagined. It's Baked Alaska. Well, chefs, we have such a glamorous menu today. It's those classics reimagined. Now we're gonna top it all off with a very classic dessert that you really don't see that much anymore, and I don't know why, because it's delicious. Baked Alaska. Now what I've got going here is I've got some of the vegan sugar with water cooking on the stove. And what we're looking for is the softball stage. So there's various stages of cooked sugar, and the softball stage is gonna mean that when we drop a little bit of sugar in the ice water, it's gonna hold together in a little ball, but it's gonna remain soft. There's also hard ball and there's hard crack, like you would cook to make, say, a candy cane or a hard candy. All right, so we're going to softball stage, so let's go ahead and give the sugar a test. I'm just gonna lift a little bit out with a spoon. Now remember that sugar is like hot lava, so you wanna be really careful. And you can see that when I put it in the water, it really does stay soft. It doesn't turn hard like a candy cane or a piece of hard candy. All right, so we're perfect. I'm gonna take that off for just a moment and give it a whisk. Let's kill that fire. Now, I've got a dark chocolate gluten-free cake here, and we're just going to cut out some rounds. This is going to be the base for our baked Alaska. Now, this does happen to be a gluten-free cake, which is wonderful, and the dark chocolate's loaded with flavonoids that prevent plaque from building up, particularly in our brain, which can prevent and help us with anything related to stroke. All right, I've got my stand mixer going. I've got 4 egg whites at room temperature, and I'm just gonna dump that in and let's let it rip. All right, so we're gonna bring those up to soft peak, and what that means is that when you lift the egg white, the peak will fold over. It won't hold a nice stiff peak. And so we're at soft ball and we're at soft peak for our meringue. All right, let's let that go for just a minute. Now, I've got a little decoration here that we'll use later. I'm gonna get the balls that I made earlier of ice cream out of the freezer, and we're gonna park one of those right on our cake and then back into the freezer. So let me grab that. All right, we're at soft peak, we're at soft ball. Our plate is nice and chilled to help us hold everything, and we're ready to stream our hot sugar in. Now be careful here, chefs. This is like hot lava. So we're just gonna come over here and we're gonna stream it right into the egg whites. And that's gonna cook the meringue. There we are. Let's put this to the back and see how we're doing. Beautiful. Let's let it go just another minute. And I'm gonna finish this by hand. We'll just go ahead and use our whisk. Look at how glossy and gorgeous that is. Let's get the bowl off. Let me get my whisk here and we'll just finish it by hand. Beautiful. All right, you can see how glossy the eggs are cooked by the hot sugar. And we're all set. All right. You can tell that it's done when it gets that nice gloss to it. Now, don't bang all the air out. You can knock it a little bit, but don't bang it all out. Now, you could put this in a piping bag and pipe it over attractively, but we're just going to put it on and make it a little more of a rustic presentation. All right, looking good. All right, I'm kind of liking the rustic presentation. It looks like a big poofy cloud. And when we come back, we're gonna take everything to the plate and get yet another chef's toy out, our brulee torch. Now we're gonna get a nice golden color on the meringue, and I've got a little treat here with a golden egg. We'll put it all together when we get back. All right, gourmet chefs everywhere and those that just enjoy gourmet food, I hope you see how easily you can put something really great together that is a most favorite classic. Now we've got our reimagined twice-baked potato and we use the yam, candied pecans, a little bit of coconut and some orange juice. We've got our seared beef tenderloin here with our beautiful Marsala wild mushroom sauce. You can see the little biscuit will give you that nice crispy texture that the beef Wellington is known for. All right, let's go ahead and add a little color to our meringue. I'm gonna just take the torch and gently go over the meringue. You can keep it back just a little bit and that's perfect. I've got a little treat here that I got at the craft store, and it is edible gold, so it's not gonna hurt you. We're just gonna put the little hollowed out egg on there, and it adds just a bit of beauty and a more gourmet touch to your beautiful baked Alaska. Put a little bit of your Frangelico liqueur inside, and your guests can pick the egg up and pour the Frangelico around for another layer of flavor. That's it for the Ageless Kitchen. I hope you've enjoyed the classics reimagined as much as I've enjoyed creating them for you. A gourmet meal, any night of the week, it's well within your reach. I'm Chef Tina, here's to your health.